Narayana Goswami Maharaja Ki Jai. Nityalila Prakashitam Vishnu Padastotra Sarasvata Shri Srimad Bhakti Rakshak Shri Dhari Goswami Maharaj Ki Jai. Nityalila Prakashitam Vishnu Padastotra Sarasvata Shri Srimad Bhakti Pragyan Keshava Goswami Maharaj Ki Jai. Tadiya Avir Bhav Mahamahotsav Titi Param Guru Dev Srila Bhakti Pragyan Keshava Goswami Maharaj Ki Jai. Jagat Guru Dev Srila Keshava Goswami Maharaj Ki Jai. Nityalila Pravishta Om Vishnu Padastotra Sata Shishimad Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. Mahabhagavat Srila Gauri Kishore Das Goswami Maharaj Ki Jai. Shri Srila Sachidananda Bhakti Vinod Thakur Ki Jai. Vaishnava Sarvam Srila Jagannathas Babaji Maharaj Ki Jai. Shri Rupa Rupa Guru Varga Ki Jai. Shri Gauri Vedanta Charja Bhadi Vajamashan Prabhu Ki Jai. Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur Ki Jai. Srila Narottam Srinivasyananda Prabhu Trai Ki Jai. Srila Krishna Das Kaviraj Goswami Prabhu Ki Jai. Sri Rupa Sanatan Bhattara Gurnath Sri Jiva Gopala Bhattara Das Raghunath Sri Goswami Prabhu Ki Jai. Srila Sarutama Dhar Vajranandari Gaur Parshaka Vrinda Ki Jai. Namacharja Srila Haridas Thakur Ki Jai. Prem Sigo Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadhara Srivasadi Gaura Bhaktavinda Ki Jai. Sri Sri Navadvipa Dhamma Ki Jai. Sri Jagannath Puri Kshetra Dhamma Ki Jai. Sri Vrindavan Dhamma Ki Jai. Shri Shri Radha Krishna Gopa Gopi Gopa Vardhan Dvadasha Vadatmaka Shri Vrajmanda Dhamma Ki Jai. Shri Shyama Kunda Radha Kunda Yamuna Ganga Tulasi Bhakti Devi Ki Jai. Shri Giriraj Govardhan Maharaja Ki Jai. Grantra Srimad Bhagavatam Ki Jai. Bhakti Vidyanashana Shri Nishinda Deva Ki Jai. Bhakta Pravadishi Pralad Maharaja Ki Jai. Charo Dham Charo Sampradaya Charo Acharja Ki Jai. Akramatra Shri Chaitanya Vat Ki Jai. Shri Vishva Vaishnavra Sabhat Ki Jai. Ananta Koti Vaishnava Vrinda Ki Jai. Tri Bhuvana Pavana Harinama Sankirtana Ki Jai. Sachinandan Gaur Hari Ki Jai. Shri Nityananda Prabhu Ki Jai. Shri Panja Tattva Ki Jai. Samaveta Bhakta Vrinda Ki Jai. Samagata Gaur Bhakta Vrinda Ki Jai. Nitai Gaur Premanande. Om Jnana Timirandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurana Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha. Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prishtaya Bhutale Srimate Bhaktivedanta Swamiti Nama. Om Vishnu Padaya Radhikai Priyatmane Shri Srimad Bhaktivedanta Narayaniti Nama. Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prishtaya Bhutale Srimate Bhaktirakshak Shridharati Nama. Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Acharya Singha Rupine Shri Srimad Bhakti Pragyana Keshava Iti Name. Ati Madhya Charitraya Svasritanam Chapalane Jiva Dukke Sadarkaya Shri Nama Premadaya Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prasthaya Srimati Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Nama Vancha Kalpataru Bhascha Kripa Sindhu Vyeva Cha Patitanam Bhavane Vyo Vaishnavi Vyo Namo Namaha Namaha Vadanay Krishna Prema Pridayate Krishnaya Krishna Chaitanya Namne Gaurati Hey Krishna, Karuna, Sindho, Dina Bandho, Jagadapati, Gopesh, Gopika Kanta, Radha Kanta, Namostate, Dakti Kanchana Gaurangi, Radhe Vrindavaneshwari, Vrishabhan Suti Devi, Namami Hari Priya Vrindai Tulsimai Priyai Kishavasthita Krishna Bhakti Pradi Devi Satya Vachai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Shri Vasadi Gaura Bhakta Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama. First of all, I'm offering my unlimited dandavat pranams, my shraddha pushpanjali, at the lotus feet of my Guru Gurudev, Nitya Lila Pravishta, Om Vishnu Pad, Astratarasata Sri Srila, A.C. Bhakti Vedanta, Swami Maharaj, Sri Prabhupada. I'm offering my same unlimited dandavat pranams and my shraddha pushpanjali at the lotus feet of my beloved Siksha Gurudevs, Nitya Lila Pravishta, Om Vishnu Pad, Astro Tarasata Sri Sri Bhakti Vedanta, Narayan Goswami Maharaj, and Nitya Lila Pravishta, Om Vishnu Pad, Astro Tarasata Sri Sri Bhakti Rakshak Sri Dhar Goswami Maharaj. And then I'm offering on this most auspicious transcendental appearance day of the empowered, pure devotee of Sri Krishna and Sri Gauranga Mahaprabhu, who descended into this world to assist his eternal Gurudev, Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur. That is none other than our most revered, our most worshipable, Nitya Lila Pravishta, Om Vishnu Pad Astra Tarasata, Sri Srila Bhakti Pragyan. And Dandavat pranams to all my Sri Rupa Anuga Guru Varna, and my Dandavat pranams to all the Vaishnavas and the Vaishnavis here in this glorious assembly on the bank of the great ocean in Sri Jagannath Puri Dham at Sri Chakratirtha by the mercy of our beloved Guru Dev, and to all the Siddhanti Sannyasi Gan, Senior Vaishnavas, Vaishnavas, my Dandavat Pranams. So our Srila Gurudev, Srila Bhaktivedanta Narayan Goswami Maharaj, through him, hearing from him, and also from reading the wonderful presentation that he made of the biography of his most worshipable Gurudev, Srila Bhakti Prajnana Keshav Goswami Maharaj. So we came to meet this divine personality in our hearts, although none of us had personally, physically seen him or met him. But, and neither did we really know that much about him, because our Guru Maharaj, Srila A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, he was absorbed in presenting the entire unlimited transcendental world of the Srimad Bhagavatam, Bhagavad Gita, and the Holy Vaishnava Siddhanta. So he did not speak so much about his grandmothers. But when he heard the news that this particular godmother had departed from this world, that was in 1968. Yes, and Srila Prabhupada was at that time in Seattle, Washington, in the United States. And he wrote a condolence letter. And he also gave a lecture which was recorded on that day. So from that lecture, we could, although we didn't hear it back then, but in more recent times, we were able to hear that lecture and to hear his voice choked with emotion. And how he expressed that this devotee, this God brother, he really through my Guru Maharaj, through him, he had given me this great benediction and practically forced me to take the renounced order of life. And he was so overwhelmed on that day to hear that this personality had departed from this world. His moods were very, very deep. Tears and weeping came. None of the devotees had ever witnessed that in him expressing about any godbrother. He had shown such emotions on the appearance or disappearance days of his Guru Maharaj, Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur, but not for any other godbrother. So Srila Prabhupada had a very deep, intimate relationship with him, which we would learn later on from the most intimate disciple of Srila Bhakti Prajnana Keshav Maharaj, that is our beloved Gurudev Srila Bhaktivedanta Narayan Goswami Maharaj, and how he revealed the glories of his Guru Maharaj in an unparalleled way. Anyone that reads that book, I want to say that, you know, Srila Gurudev was so much pleased with the publication of that book, so joyful that his Guru Maharaj would be glorified everywhere, and now for the first time all over the world, people would know who is this personality. What level of Vaishnava was he? What was his incomparable seva to the lotus feet of Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur? All these histories, how he preached, how he restarted the entire Gaudiya Math after everything had ground to a halt. This empowered personality, how he was fully surrendered his life to the lotus feet of his Guru Maharaj to save the life of his Guru Maharaj. He risked his own life. He is known throughout all of Gaudiya Math for this. This heroic, selfless, absolutely sacrificing mood and seva. Oh, so many things. His inner moods, his internal moods, his contributions, his literary contributions. Just a long list, this biography shows. Anyone who is a disciple of Srila Bhaktivedanta Narayan Maharaj, or in this line, coming down from him, They must read this biography cover to cover. And if you haven't done it, you should do it starting today. Because it is a treasure. And I can say, my own experience, even though by the time his book came out, we had heard about Srila Bhakti Pragyan Keshav Maharaj from the lips of our Gurudev a number of times over the years, especially on his disappearance day, the first day of Kartik. He disappeared from this world, so that every year, that first day of Kartik celebrates that glorious personality. And we would sit with Srila Gurudev and hear from him and his emotions, how his heart would just be drenched with separation movement, and he would express that. Sometimes he couldn't even speak. But then when the biography came out, and we were able to hear the details, it's an amazing experience. Amazing experience. Because we want to have very close, intimate, deep relationships in our hearts with these exalted, empowered Gaur Bhaktas in our Guru Parampara. Every one of them, we want to meet them in our hearts. So when this most essential personality was introduced after so many years of being in this line, in this movement, we were overjoyed to hear who he is, what his contributions have been. And one thing about that biography is that I was quite astonished after, you know, hearing from Gurudev and traveling with him and seeing how he presented the Siddhanta, just like we heard this class and all of his incredible lectures. But when I read the biography, I was astonished. And I actually told the devotees, I said, I'm amazed. Gurudev has actually presented everything that he wanted to say. His whole mission, his whole purpose of coming to the whole world. It's all beautifully presented in this biography. The systematic presentation of all the Siddhanta, from Das Mool Tattva, 10 Essential Principles of Mahaprabhu, and explaining all the preaching tactics of his Guru Maharaj, how he preached, so many different moods of his preaching, what he would preach, what in his writings, how Gurudev presented for the latter part of the book, his writings, especially his song that he wrote, the Mangal Artik song that we sing every morning, so filled with rus that all of his godbrothers were astonished. They approached him and they said, we never knew how rusty personality you are that you put in this song, this Mangal Artik song, simple Bengali language, you put the whole Govinda Lilamrita, all the pastimes, and you expressed it in such poetic beauty. We never knew this about you. And his Radha Vinod Bihari Tattva is to come, 8 verses glorifying Shri Krishna in the mood of Radha Vinod Bihari. That contribution is very unique in all of Gaudiya Math, in all of Gaudiya Vaishnava lines. Srila Bhakti Pragyan Keshav Maharaj's internal mood came in his establishing of this deity that is in all of our temples. Shri Krishna as Radha Vinod Bihari. And that tattva is very deep. So he wrote an ashtakam to explain this tattva of Radha Vinod Bihari. Why has Krishna turned golden color? This occurred, this incident actually occurred on the banks of the Yamuna in Sri Vrindavan, right next to Gurudev's current temple, Gopinath Bhavan, called the place called Imlitala. And Sri Krishna, in extreme separation mode from Srimati Radha, when she left the Das, and when he took her and disappeared, and he came there under this Imli, tamarind tree. And Sri Krishna was so absorbed in the separation from Srimati Radhika, and so absorbed in thinking about her, all of her qualities. Radha Chinta Niveshena. It means that he became Radha Chinta Nivesh. Just like Shakti Avesh, that overwhelmed completely, his whole being overwhelmed by her. Chinta Niveshena. Yasya Kantir Vilopita. What happened then? He not only became absorbed internally, externally, her golden color completely covered him from head to toe. So, then what is the next line? Lopita. Sri Krishna Tamaham Bande Radha Lingita Vigra.
Charanam
Vande. I am offering my vandanam, my prayers to that Krishna, to his lotus feet. Radha Lingita Vigraham. The Vigraha, the form of Krishna, who is now fully embraced head to toe by Radha. That was beautiful amongst our Gaudiya Parampara. And that was manifested by Srila Bhakti Pradhan Keshav Maharaj when he established his temples. He installed that form of Krishna, not dark, not blackish color, and his tattva ashtakam goes into more detail about that. And some persons were wondering, why has Keshav Maharaj, some of his godbrothers, why has he installed Krishna with white marble? Because the deities are carved, most of them, from marble or from brass. But he has not made Krishna dark color. All the other deities in Vrindavan are blackish. Even all the deities from the ancient times, thousands of years before, were all blackish color. But this Keshav Maharaj, he has installed Krishna with a light color. Golden color. Why he's done this? But he revealed that in his tattva ashtaka. So, this was his mood. And this was the mood of his disciple, our Gurudev, Srila Bhaktivedanta Narayan Maharaj, was the encapsulant of the mood of the heart of his Gurudev. So that exalted personality, what kind of servant, sevak, guru sevak, he was. No one can compare, practically speaking. He is like the stories that Gurudev would tell about other ancient guru sevaks like Kuresh and Aruni, and others who risk their lives, their very lives, to follow the instructions of their Gurudev. So, today we can hear something about these glories of Srila Bhakti Pradhan Keshav Maharaj, and also this evening there will be a gathering of all the different Gaudiya Mathas will come here, and our revered Srila Bhakti Vigyan Bharati Maharaj will also come here. He has seen, he has associated with this personality. So we look forward to hearing his glorification. So you know, in the beginning of Gurudev's biography, I just wanted to read a few of his introductory words.
What time is it will come?
What?
And what time will be this program with all the
money? I don't know.
Seven.
Okay, seven? That way.
Seven till nine.
No, evening. Tonight.
Oh, evening.
Yeah. So, this is the very first paragraph that Gurudev wrote in this biography, the first part. It is entitled Bhagavat Guru Parampara. Bhagavat Guru Parampara. And his Guru Maharaj also wrote a very powerful article, which we have, of describing what is this Guru Parampara called Bhagavat Parampara. Very unique, unlike other, sometimes they're called seminal paramparas, by hereditary bloodlines. No, Bhagavata parampara is the real parampara, and he explained that thoroughly. That's actually in this book also. Many of his writings and articles and so forth are in this biography. So Gurudev begins by saying, in accordance with the needs of the times and for the welfare of the world, the supremely merciful Sri Bhagavan and his dear associates descend, bringing the gifts of their instructions. They drive far away all godless persons whose atheistic thoughts are averse to Dharma, and they establish Sanatana Dharma in the form of Shuddha Bhakti, which is the means for the eternal welfare of the jivas. In the present Yuga, with its powerful influence of Kali, Sri Gaur Sundar, the munificent incarnation of Kali Yuga, he saves the fallen souls by bestowing, praying, love of God, which had not been given previously. His followers, who are themselves in the line of Sri Sarup Damodar and Rupa Goswami, have appeared on this earth as Sri Gaur Sundar's potencies in the form of acharyas. They appear in order to immerse the ignorant jivas who are intoxicated by materialism in Shuddha Prema Dharma, pure love of God. By the desire of Sri Bhagavan, these acharyas are infallible scriptural use, these acharyas use infallible scriptural evidence and irrefutable logic to demolish and utterly destroy the non-Vedic doctrine of Acharya Sri Shankara. This philosophy, which is known as Brahmavad, describes Parabrahman as one, Nirvishesh, and Nishakti. So Nirvishesh means having no differentiation, all just oneness. And Nishakti means having no Shakti. So it is a concealed form of Bodhavad, Buddhism, Advaitavad, Monism, and Mayavad philosophy. So having accomplished this, the Acharyas have established the authentic and transcendental Bhagavat Tattva, which establishes Parabrahman as Savishesh. That means having all qualities, all attributes. And Sarva Shaktiman, having all potencies and powers. And Rasa Swarupa, the very embodiment of all rasa. So among these followers of Sri Gaur Sundar, among these followers of Sri Gaur Sundar, who did this establishing, the worshipable Acharya, Keshari, Pashanda Gajaita Singha, Om Vishnupad, Ashtotara Shanda, Sri Srimad Bhakti Pragyan Keshav Goswami Maharaj, is the foremost. This is the Bhav of Gurudev's heart. This worshipable Guru Maharaj. He's called Acharya Keshari. That means the best amongst the great acharyas in the line of Sri Gaur Sundar. And Pashanda Gajaika Simha. What is that? Pashanda means atheists. Pashanda. Not believers in any absolute truth, reality. And that includes these categories that we just heard. Mayavad, Buddhism, Sahajism, all. So, we often see that especially here in Jagannath Puri, we also see figures. When you enter into temples, in the entryways, you'll see figures of lions, and you'll also see figures of elephants. And sometimes you'll see the lion on top of the elephant, showing that the elephant has been defeated, even though so big. But the lion is so fierce and so powerful that he even can kill and defeat the elephant. In our Govardhan Mutt, there's also such figures shown. So, Gaja means elephant, and Singha means lion. So, what does this indicate? This indicates that those Pashandis, they are like these elephants, the elephants of so many anarthas that are inhibiting the jivas from being able to come to the lotus feet of Bhagavan and serve his lotus feet. So those elephantine vices, it is called, they become completely conquered over by the Singha, by the lion-like acharyas, by their powerful preaching, and they drive away, just like the lion, by his roar, drives away all the bogus, nonsense, cheating rascals who are misleading all the general masses of people from attaining their ultimate good fortune. Bhagavat Prem. So such personality, Srila Gurudev said, is my worshipable Acharya Keshagi, Srila Bhakti Prakhyana Kesha Goswami. And then he says, Sajinandan Gaur Hari, who is Sri Krishna himself, possessing all the specialities of the previous incarnations, and radiant with the mood and luster of Srimati Radhika, he appeared 500 years ago together with his own associates. In a very short time, through the process of Nam Sankirtan, Sri Gaur Hari spread Bhakti Rasa, the mellows of pure love of God, throughout the entire world, in order to fulfill the Lord's innermost desire. His dear associate, Srila Rupa Goswami, established Shuddha Bhakti Rasa in his Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, in his Sri Ujjvala Nilamani and other literature. And recently, Jagat Varenya Ashtotara Shata Sri Srimad Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Goswami Prabhupada, the crown jewel of the Acharyas in the mind of Srila Rupa Goswami, he powerfully inundated the whole world with the wave of pure bhakti. And amongst the Mahapurushas who sincerely and selflessly contributed to the spread of the teachings of Srila Prabhupada, Om Vishnupad Sri Srimad Bhakti Pragyan Keshav Goswami is the foremost. So twice, Srila Gurudev in one paragraph has glorified his Guru Maharaj in such exalted way as the foremost. This is the mood of the real disciple. But he is not exaggerating. He will, if anyone reads, then they will understand how he is foremost. Does it mean that the others, who are also exalted acharyas in the line of Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur, are also not on the same level? No, but this is the mood of the disciple. My Guru Maharaj, he is the topmost and foremost. But he's not just giving some empty praise. And I remember that we accompanied our Gurudev to his first tour in the Western countries, in America. And on his final location before returning back to India, after his incredible victory tour everywhere that he went, then he came to the location in New York City where his revered Sikh Guru, Srila Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj, our Srila Prabhupada, where he first established the Krishna consciousness movement in the Western world and performed a miraculous feat of actually putting roots down in Western soil and beginning the growth of the Bhakti Lata in the hearts of his very, very neophyte Western followers, the very first time in the history that such a thing had taken place. So Srila Gurudev was very anxious to go there because throughout his tour, he kept on mentioning this. He kept on mentioning how Srila Swami Maharaj, Swamiji he used to call him affectionately, that he came to the West with nothing. And he sat underneath a tree and he began to chant with kartals. Sri Krishna Chaitanya, Prabhu Nityananda, Sri Advaita Gadadhar, Shivasadi Gaur Bhaktavrinda, with his eyes closed in intense meditation, absorbed in the mercy mood of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. How he did this, Gurudev would mention this, and he would mention that I want to go to the places where he preached, because those places, they are very exalted tirthas on the earth. Tirtha means a holy dham, a holy place. He wanted to take the dust, he said, from those holy places on his head. Such reverence, such worshipable reverence. So he finally came to the park, near to that storefront, 26 Second Avenue, and we were very excited to be there with him and to accompany him to the very tree where Srila Prabhupada was photographed standing in the park, surrounded by all different types of immigrants and different people and the people of that time, and preaching the message of Mahaprabhu. He's on a cover of a newspaper from the Lower East Side village of New York City. And then Gurudev did kirtan with us. They're circumambulating that tree. And he heard from Shamrani Didi how she met Prabhupada in that very place. It was the place where she first met him. And then we quickly ran to the vehicles that we had waiting and came about a mile away to the storefront. We all came into the storefront as quickly as possible. And Gurudev arrived. You can see this. It was captured by our Rasaraj Prabhu Han video. This historical event. And even though it was not very good quality video, but, you know, it's there. And the lecture was recorded. And, you know, Srila Gurudev was in a very extremely deep, overwhelmed emotional mood. You know, and when he first began to speak, he had some others speaking first, and then he began to lecture, and he paid his pranams, his mangala charana. And then he mentioned the name of his Guru Maharaj, Bhakti Pragyan Keshav Maharaj, mentioned the name of our Srila Swami Maharaj, and then his eyes welled with tears, and he said, as I sit here now in this place, I'm remembering Swamiji and seeing in the eyes of my mind as if there are movie reels. In other words, all of his memories of being with Prabhupada, all of his memories of being with Prabhupada in Vrindavan, in Keshav Jigoni Mata Mathura when he first arrived from his giving up his family life, coming there. His memories of speaking with our Prabhupada and telling him, you are so qualified, you must take some class. His memories of convincing his Guru Maharaj when he came, his Guru Maharaj, Bhakti Pragyan Keshav Maharaj, came there to Mathura, and he approached his Guru Maharaj and he said, Our Bhakti Vedanta, our Abhay Charanada Vindaprabhu Bhakti Vedanta, he is here. He's been staying here. And I'm requesting you, please, convince him to take sannyas. And how Srila Bhakti Pragyan Keshav Maharaj intimately spoke with our Srila Prabhupada, who would later become Bhakti Vedanta Swami Maharaj, and convinced him, you must do this. You must take sannyas. This instruction of our Guru Maharaj, Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur, it is your responsibility. He has given this to you. You must do it. You cannot do this unless you take the monastery. You must do it. He convinced you. So our Srila Prabhupada became Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj. And the Vishwarupa was of day receiving this from his exalted worshipable godmother, Bhakti Pragyan Keshav Maharaj. What was their relationship? Oh, Srila Gurudev, sitting in the New York City, was remembering all these things. He was remembering how the very first time that he saw Srila A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami as a householder, just after he came to the Golden Rut in 1946, end of 46 or beginning of 47, he always used to say. Just at that time. And he was in a big assembly with his Guru Maharaj in some Calcutta somewhere. And this is a big assembly, there was a stage, and his Guru Maharaj was sitting up on the stage with other sannyasis, godbrothers, and suddenly his Guru Maharaj began to gesture to someone in the back of the room who was entering, in the back of the probably a big pandal tent, you know, with a few thousand people. And he turned, this new devotee, new disciple of Bhakti Pragyan Keshav Maharaj, who was known as Gaur, or who was going to be initiated as Gaur Narayan, or maybe he was already initiated. No, he was already initiated, yes, as Gaur Narayan. So he looked and he saw a householder who was moving toward the front, and he looked at his Guru Maharaj, and his Guru Maharaj was calling him to come and sit with them on the stage. And so he asked. Srila Gurudev was not shy.
Brought him on the stage and brought him up onto his own seat.
He brought him up on the stage onto his own seat.
And you have to understand the etiquette of going by at a time. The whole stage was just red cloth, brahmacharis. And I think he might have been the only sannyasi sitting up on this asana. And he not only brought him onto the stage, but someone else for him. Declining, but being waved on, he had to sit on the same seat with him.
Yes.
And then,
yeah.
What is this? Who is this?
Yeah.
Why are you doing this?
Yeah, Gurudev. Yes. No, but he asked him. He actually asked him.
Later. He always described that he looked at him and looked at his eyes. They had this exchange.
You've clarified. I always thought it was as he was walking. Then he was saying, "Who is this? Who is this Vaishnava?" And then Srila Bhakti Pragyan Keshav Maharaj told him, "This is a very, very intimate disciple of our Guru Maharaj, Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur. You should carefully note him. You should carefully observe him, carefully. You should hear from him, and you should serve him." Those three things he told him. How Gurudev must have been remembering Srila Prabhupada in that 22nd Avenue with the movie reels of all of his exchanges with this divine personality. Oh my God, how he must have been remembering all the times when they were together in the case of Jagodiyamat. Gurudev said, "We live together in such a sweet way. Oh, and sometimes laughing and joking in so intimate friendship. And sometimes doing kirtan together," he would say. "I remember Swamiji would sit in the temple room and sing Gauranga Balite Have Pulaka Sharir," weeping and weeping. How he had this relationship with our Guru. Yes, and how he performed the sannyas ceremony. Gurudev actually spoke about this in that lecture that he gave. But as he was remembering, his eyes welled up with tears. Then he took his cloth and paused. And then he resumed his lecture and he said, I am now realizing. I am realizing that my Guru Maharaj and Srila Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj are on the same level, same platform. And Gurudev used to tell us this in different ways. And one time in a Kartik festival, when we were celebrating Srila Bhakti Rakshak Sridhar Maharaj's appearance day, which always happens during Kartik month, then at that time, Srila Gurudev was presiding over this festival in the Lupsanatan Gaudiya Mat, and he, because he knew that I was connected with Srila Sridhar Maharaj, so sometimes he would have me be the master of ceremonies and call on speakers and so forth. There weren't that many on this occasion. And when Gurudev was speaking, then he said, looking at me, looking at Pran Kishore, who was also with Srila Sridhar Maharaj, Kirtapada Prabhu and a couple of others, Uddhava Prabhu, whether he was there or not, I don't remember. But he said to us, he said, do you know why Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj, why he took sannyas from my Guru Maharaj and not from Pujapad Bhakti Rakshak Sridhar Maharaj? Do you know why? And I thought, well, I've heard some explanations that Srila Sridhar Maharaj himself gave, why he didn't take sannyas from him. Because he had an intimate relationship with Srila Bhakti Rakshak Sridhar Maharaj. There's no question. He himself told that. And he lived with him for like 8 years in Calcutta before Prabhupada left family life. He had many intimate exchanges. There's a lecture where Prabhupada himself is telling us about his relationship with Srila Sridhar Maharaj. So here Gurudev is kind of telling me, do you know why he took sannyas from my Guru Maharaj and not from Bhakti Rakshak Sridhar Maharaj?
And Prabhupada asked Sridhar Maharaj to give him sannyas, to ask him personally. So.
Yeah, that's true.
But he refused.
Yeah, but still, Gurudev, he had a specific point he wanted to make to us, which would enrich tremendously our understanding of what kind of relationship these two personalities had. This world preacher, Jagat Guru, who brought the Krishna consciousness known to the entire world, and this, what is it, Pashanda Gajaika Singha, this Singha, lion, Acharya, Srila Bhakti Pragyan Keshava, who were these two persons? What were their natures? Why it occurred that Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj took sannyas from him? So actually at that time, it was a little bit startling to us, because we always thought that, like the way that Srila Sridhar Maharaj expressed it was that he felt that it would not be so favorable if it was him that would give sannyas to Srila Keshava, to Srila Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj. Why? He said, because I lived in the home and interacted so much with the family members, his family members, naturally, you see. So it would be not so good if I was the person who would give the renounced order to him, you see. So actually I mentioned that to Gurudev. I said, well, I've heard Srila Sridhar Maharaj himself say that it's for this reason. Gurudev said, no, this is not the reason. And then he told the reason. He said, because he took sannyas from my Guru Maharaj, because they were bosom friends. Very simple. They're bosom friends. And then I thought, you know, at that time in my mind I thought, well, was he not a bosom friend of Srila Bhakti Rajak Sridhar Maharaj? Of course he was. They were also bosom friends. But Gurudev was, in a cryptic way, he was now implanting in our hearts something that would later manifest and flower and bloom, you know? So then we began to contemplate this as time went by. And when, especially when the biography came out, and now we were meeting Srila Bhakti Pragyan Keshamaj in person through this biography, and seeing his preaching style, his nature, his just everything about him. And then we began to understand, these two persons were so internally connected. Their mood of preaching, because Srila Sridhar Maharaj, you know, he himself told many, many times, it's written also, he would say, my nature was to withdraw. To withdraw, here's my nature. And he would even grapple with that sometimes, because his Guru Maharaj's nature was so outward pushing and so challenging, lion-like. But his nature was somewhat withdrawing. Although he was also a bold preacher, but he never liked to be in the front and leading like this. You see, he didn't like. And even our Srila Prabhupada, later, when he was introducing Srila Sridhar Maharaj, he said, this is my revered godbrother, Srila Bhakti Rakshak Sridhar Maharaj. By age and by experience, he is senior to me. And our Guru Maharaj told that he is one of the best preachers of Krishna consciousness in the whole world. Our Guru Maharaj departed from this world, I wanted to start another institution, making Sridhar Maharaj the head. But I could not do it. And like that, and I wanted to bring him everywhere, but he could not go. So, the natures of these pure devotees, it is very interesting. They all have their swabhav, their natures. Although they're topmost exalted Mahabhagwats, but they have their individual personalities. But the personality and nature and mood of service to Guru, of Bhakti Pragyan Keshamaraj, and this person, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj, were very much the same. And they were very, very bold and, you know, straightforward and challenging, conquering kind of personalities. And how did Srila Gurudev know this? Because he witnessed his Guru Maharaj and this Srila Prabhupada sitting together and discussing about the deviation of their god brothers and discussing how they're going to write an article and they're going to correct their god brothers and point out and like this. You know, what is called Sampradaya Rakshana, the protection of the Sampradaya. They have this mood, and sometimes they would joke a bit also. Yes, yes, we'll write this and we'll write that. He witnessed this.
Also, he was helping
Mother. Yes, and Srila Bhakti Pragyan Keshav Maharaj, okay, in 1941, Srila Bhakti Pragyan Keshav Maharaj, about 5 years after the disappearance of his Guru Maharaj, Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur, and the Gaudiya Mutt had gone through so many divisions and so much difficulty after that, it was like a dark cloud came over, you know, the whole line of Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati, and all the preaching practically ground to a halt, factually speaking. Printing presses stopped so much. It was a difficult time. So, this godbrother, this disciple, very boldly, he assembled a few of his godbrothers. And he restarted this mission, this preaching mission. And he formed what would become known all throughout the world as the Gaudiya Vedanta Samiti. He established a new society and registered it on this day, Akshaya Tritiya, 1941. And there were three persons who were the founders of this society on the legal documents. One person, of course, Srila Bhakti Pragyan Keshav Maharaj. Another person was? Which? Bhakti Kamala Madhusudan Maharaj. Another disciple of Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati and very intimate friend and godbrother of Bhakti Pradhanakesha. Yeah, he was Brahmachari, and his name was Narottamananda Brahmachari. He was actually the first person that our Gurudev met from Gaudiya Math, preaching the message of Mahaprabhu, Gauranga Mahaprabhu, in Bihar province, where Gurudev was living. And that Narottamananda Brahmachari became Gurudev's first Sikha Guru. And he also had an exchange with him, not in Bengali, not in Hindi, but in English language, because neither of them knew the other's language, but they both knew English. So Gurudev's first exchange and hearing the Siddhanta was in the English language, quite foretelling for the future. So, so the third founding person of the society, he chose our A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, who was in household life at that time, doing business, looking after his family. But he knew that he's a Param Vaishnava. He knew this about him, although he's in household life. And he was the person co-founding with him this society. So, that's another very definite sign. What kind of intimate relationship they have. Actually, when Srila Prabhupada Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj, when he was in his household years, after meeting Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur for the first time in 1921, then later on he went to the city of Allahabad, which is now called Prayag, where the Ganga and Yamuna flows, and they have the big Kumbh Mela festival, and Srila Prabhupada started the pharmacy there. I think we called it Allahabad Pharmacy. And at that time he was visited by preachers from the Gaudiya Math. And Srila Bhakti Rakshak Sridhar Maharaj was part of that party. And at a later time, when the breakup of the Gaudiya Math was occurring, and there were some court cases actually, that were leveled against some of the godbrothers. And so they went into hiding and they came there to Allahabad. And at that time, Srila Prabhupada hosted them and had many intimate exchanges with Srila Bhakti Pradhanakesha Maharaj. So there's so much history of their relationship. But Gurudev especially told us that he must take sannyas from my Guru Maharaj. And Gurudev indicated in a kind of covered way that he must take from my Guru Maharaj because it is the anugatya. It is the anugatya from the spiritual realm. What does that mean? There in the divine realm of Radha and Krishna's eternal pastimes. Oh, they are serving the lotus feet of Srimati Radhika there, and there is a hierarchy. A jutta, a group, a very intimate group of gopis. Right? They are there. So, now, Gurudev, he preached in that lecture that he gave there in New York City. He also mentioned how Srila Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj received sannyas from my Guru Maharaj. And he also mentioned how he himself was acting as the priest for the yajna. He prepared everything. He performed the yajna, chanted the mantras. And he also instructed and demonstrated to Srila Prabhupada how to put on the sannyas vesh. Dor Gobind, the longi, dhoti, and the uttariya. He is the one that showed them. So, in one sense, Srila Bhaktivedanta Narayan Maharaj, he was senior to Prabhupada by sannyas, because he had taken sannyas in 1952, And Prabhupada took sannyasa in 1959. Okay. And, but one time I was suggesting to Gurudev that he should have a biography in front of, you know, in the front or in the back of his English books that were now coming out. That there should be an autobiographical sketch of him. You know, who is the author, about the author, like they have in so many books. Gurudev was a little reluctant. That was back in 1995, before he went to the West. So I was suggesting this to him. And anyway, he said, okay, you can write one or two paragraphs. So then I began to research from Madhav Maharaj's, he had written some paper of some of Gurudev's life, which was very nice. I used that as the basis, and then I wrote this introductory about the author. And I came and I read it to Gurudev. And I also wanted to ask him if it was appropriate that I should mention his relationship with Srila A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, because now he's also going to come to the West, and we didn't know he was coming to the West at that time, but his books are going to go to the West, and so they should know, everyone should know, what is his relationship. And so I asked him, I said, you know, you mentioned to us that you consider Srila A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj to be your Sikha Guru. So should I mention this relationship in this biography? And then he says, yes, you can mention it. He said, because I accepted him as my Siksha Guru, as one of my Siksha Gurus, because he was so senior and superior to me. He said, but then he said, but actually, I received all things from my Guru. Not that he needed completing of his through a Sikha Guru. He might have wanted that point to be known. I received all things from the Guru Maharaj. And as we would witness Srila Gurudev's preaching pastimes all throughout the world, every single day, sitting and offering his obeisances to his Guru Maharaj. Yeah.
We were in Daja, New Raja in California. Gurudev asked Madhav Maharaj and myself, do you know why I am successful everywhere, all over the world? Everyone is attracted and inspired by my Harikatha and my books, everything. You know why? Then Madhav Maharaj says, thank you. He says, because you're Rajan. Yes, but that is not the main important thing. Then he said, because the mercy of your Guru Maharaj, Srila Bhakti Prachyanka is he says, no. Then Madhav Maharaj does not come with any more answers. Very rare, he has no answers anymore. Yeah. Then Gurudev said, it is because of the mercy of Srila Bhakti that I am Swami Maharaj. Only because of his mercy, everywhere around the world, all are respecting me, and my teachings, they are so much inspiring the devotees to become more and more serious about Krishna.
Yeah, actually, he mentioned this quite often, he's saying. He also said that about Srila Bhakti Rakshak Sridhar Maharaj. He said, if it was not for his relationship with Swami Maharaj, Swami, he said, no one would have known him. No one would have known him. Neither would they have known me. So, but what the connection between Gurudev and his Guru Maharaj? That you have to read the biography to really go deeply into understanding his relationship with his Guru Maharaj. How much incredible dedication and devotion. You know, and so this personality, Bhakti Pragyan Keshav Goswami Maharaj, whose appearance day it is today, like in the biography, Gurudev is telling about his family lineage, his father's name, his mother's name, and so forth. where he was born and all of this. But then Gurudev points out in the very beginning of this first chapter, whenever he himself would speak about his lineage, his family lineage, he would never ever mention his birth parents or his bloodline, never. He would only mention his spiritual lineage, his Guru Maharaj, his Guru Maharaj's Guru Maharaj, Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati, like this. Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur. He was the powerful, as we just heard, he was the powerful personality who is the basis, the foundation for all worldwide preaching. He established Sri Gaudiya Math. But before Gaudiya Math was even established, before it was actually established, and before even Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati manifested his sannyas, this personality, Bhakti Pragyan Kesha Maharaj, who was known as Vinod Bihari Brahmachari, and before that, what was his name? Vinod. In his birth name. Yeah, we have to look it up. No, but that's a nickname. Okay, and anyway, so Srila Gurudev writes about his childhood, how he was born to such auspicious parents. And he mentions that when he was a baby, he looked so bright and golden that everyone was so attracted to this baby. And he was so peaceful. This baby was so peaceful that if you would simply put him down anywhere, he would never cry, he would just be peaceful. He would be sitting there. And because he was so attractive, everybody, they were astonished by his beauty. And they also always wanted to hold him. So he was given the name Jyotsna. And in short, Jonah, because it means moonbeam. He was so bright, like a moonbeam. So his mother called him Jonah. And so his mother, who was a very, very, very strong lady, strong, assertive, she had so much powerful nature, you know. And she was always looking after this child with so much affection. And one day, when she was giving the baby, because in Bengal, this is very customary, that the babies are massaged with mustard oil and then placed in the sun. It's extremely healthy for them. Mustard oil, top to bottom, and then placed in the sun and soak up. So, and then usually when they do this in the courtyard of their house, they attend to doing some cooking or this or that, and the baby is lying in the sun. So one day when she did this, suddenly an eagle came down. It is very rare that an eagle, you don't even see an eagle, but suddenly an eagle came down from the sky and snatched the baby in its talons, and went flying up into the air with a baby. Now, can you imagine what a mother would be feeling? So when they saw this, they were completely aghast. And they were running and screaming and waving, And then they saw them watching the eagle. And finally the eagle came very gently. The eagle came down onto a pond, a nearby pond, and placed the baby lying on a boat-like betel nut leaf, I think it was. Betel from the betel tree. The baby's lying there peacefully. And then they came and snatched the baby, you know. And then Gurudev writes how, coming coming incidents cast their shadows before they come. From this, she understood, this is no ordinary child. So also the birth chart of this child also indicated what his future would be, the birth chart, that he would be a very great, powerful acharya figure, and he would preach the message of Gauranga Mahaprabhu everywhere and save innumerable conditioned souls. That was stated in his chart. As he grew and was beginning to go to school, he showed extraordinary capacity of intelligence, but also moral character. In those days, in India, it wasn't like now, where they have all kinds of degraded Bollywood films and all these different Western influences. It was very chaste, the whole culture at that time, in the late 1800s. He was born around the same year as our Prabhupada, 1896. So, and it was British period, but the Bengal culture, it was very sophisticated culture, based on Vedic, Varnashram Dharma, and so forth. And morality was a very important thing in society, you see. And the mood of goodness, of helping others, was very much revered. So when Vinod Bihari began to go to his upper levels of school in class, like when he was probably a young teenage boy at that time, he formed a group along with some other classmates, and they began to do charity work for very needy people and people that were suffering very much, very poor, very suffering. And they would arrange for people to receive food and to receive medicine. So these boys were doing this voluntarily. Voluntarily they were doing this. So, actually Vinod Bihari's father had left the world early in his childhood. So the mother, who was a very strong-willed lady, she was now tending, because they were actually landowners, family. They were very well-to-do, very well-to-do. And she was tending to all the activities of the family and the business of landowning, ownership. So she was a strong-willed lady, but she also looked after her children very affectionately, but she was very strict. And so one day, Vinod Bihari had not returned yet from school. There was a particular time by which he was supposed to be back home, and he did not return. And so his mother was now waiting, "Where is my son?" And as the time went by, longer and longer, she began to be more and more upset that he was not home. She became very upset, and she was waiting for him to come. Now when he finally arrived, a couple of hours later, when he finally arrived, she was waiting at the doorway with a stick in her hand. "Where have you been? Why you are late?" And she was ready to give him a beating. And then Vinod Bihari looked at his mother and she said, "Oh, my dear mother, I am late because my friends and I, we have started a group to help the unfortunate downtrodden people who are suffering. And there was one lady that we were helping who had cholera, and she was a widowed lady, and we were helping her by bringing medicines for her and by establishing her in some place where she could receive medical help and food. And the money that you give to me for my lunch, to buy some snack for my lunch, I have saved that and I've utilized that to buy for her, for this lady. When his mother heard this, from the lips of her beloved son, the stick, dropped from her hand. Tears rolled down her cheeks and she embraced him. And she said, never again in your life will I ever chastise you. And from that day, Vinodbihari Brahmachari, he began showing more and more of these divine qualities. And when he was only 15 or so years old, in his school, one of his teachers was reading Chaitanya Charitamrita. And he was giving a Mayavad interpretation. And Vinodbihari spoke up against him and challenged him and defeated his own teacher. And then he began to think, what is this mundane education? What good this will do for me in my life? How I can progress toward the actual goal of life? And he began thinking that this is not for me. In that same time period, he had two aunties, who were actually disciples and followers of the great personality, Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur, who was residing at the birthplace of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu in Mayapur, Navadvipa Dham. And they went there to celebrate the festivities, just as we are going to do very shortly, to go to Navadvipa to celebrate the appearance day of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So at that time, Gaudiya Math had not even really been established, or maybe it was just starting. Not sannyas, but even the Gaudiya Math, because he established that before sannyas, the actual institution, Gaudiya Math. So anyway, these festivities were going on, and this is the first time that Vinodbihari was meeting this powerful personality, this divine, angelic angel, as described by Srila Prabhupada in his poem, who descended to this earth in Jagannath Puri Dham to save the entire world by them preaching the message of Lord Chaitanya. So now Vinodbihari is sitting in the presence of this personality. And these two ladies, they were also sitting there. And Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur, he began to describe how they are going to preach all over India, how they are going to establish all the 9 islands of Navadvipa temples, how they are going to have printing presses and distribute this message like this. And then one of the aunties, she said to Srila Prabhupada, "Oh Prabhupada, we are hearing how you are describing this future, how this will unfold and manifest, but at the present time, you don't even have enough brahmacharis to ring the bell during the Artik ceremony. So how will this come about?" And he said, "Vinod will do all things." He knew. Later on also, when he was talking about sending preachers to the West, and introducing his message all throughout the world. Wow. He was in an assembly of God, brother, of his disciples. And he also noticed the householder in the assembly, this Abhay Charanaravinda Prabhu. And when he was discussing this, how this will go all over the world, he also said, "Abhay will do everything." He knew. These personalities are not ordinary beings of this world. They are not blind, conditioned souls. They are tri-kalam gya. And what they speak, satya sankalpa, whatever they say, it will happen. Gurudev used to say that all the time about Srila Prabhupada, how he was satya sankalpa. And even Srila Prabhupada, when he was, before he started the ISKCON movement, and he was just wandering in the streets of New York City, going and sitting on a park bench here and there, And one day sitting next to an old man and talking with a man who later came to the temple after Prabhupada had departed and saw his picture and said, I know this person, I met him on a park bench. And he was telling me all about his vision and how he has many temples and how he has farms and schools and communities. And then, but he said, they are not manifest yet. But he saw everything. You see? So this is not by chance that these divine personalities came down in this world. That they had their intimate relationships with one another. That they empowered one another. That they encouraged one another. That they served one another. There was a whole coalition of them. Huh? And not just these persons. Also other disciples of Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur. So many lines coming down. Like streams. All in the line of Bhakti Vinod. Dhara. You see? So in this way, Srila Bhakti Pragyan Kesha Maharaj, now he decided, I will no longer be here in this mundane education. And now he began to become the disciple of Srila Prabhupada Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur, and he began to live there. And at that time, in Gaudiya Math, there were only a few brahmacharis, and life was very austere. We have no experience how austere, because they had such little amount of monies, and so their eating would be very, very simple, very austere. And one day, the brahmacharis were sitting, and that day, their stock of rice, and Bengalis live on rice, and that's their main staple. So their stock of rice had dwindled down. So there was only enough to give a small portion to each brahmachari. And what they did for any vegetable was on the trees they have these things called,
Drumsticks.
Drumsticks, yeah. They're like a, and you can boil them and they're a vegetable, you can eat them along.
But the leaves also.
The leaves you can also use.
We don't have the drumsticks, just the leaves.
We only have the leaves.
Oh, the drumsticks, they grow also.
Yeah.
But they use the leaves and the drumsticks.
Oh, so they didn't have them. They only had the leaves. Okay, so they made like a green leafy vegetable from that. And they're sitting there taking prasadam. And Prabhupada walked by at that time. And he saw them. He saw them. And Vinod Bihari Brahmachari saw his Guru Maharaj. And he didn't want his Guru Maharaj to feel any anxiety. So he said to him, oh Guru Maharaj, we are practicing Vairagya, detachment, renunciation. But Prabhupada saw and he knew everything. So now, those brahmacharis, they began to serve their Gurudev in the traditional way. Because brahmacharis, traditionally, in Vedic times, they would live in the ashram of their guru. And their duty as a brahmachari is to go out and beg. In Vedic culture, the begging of brahmacharis is totally acceptable. And people would give a little rice, a little bit of vegetable like this. Bhiksha. It's called bhiksha. Begging. You see? And then they would bring everything to the ashram of their guru. This is the traditional system of gurukula and living in the ashram of guru. So at that time, they used to go out begging from the public. But what they did was they had a box. They made a wooden box, small wooden box. And they made a hole in the top of it. Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati instructed this. That they make a hole that is only big enough to fit in it a coin, which I was like very small portion. One, not even pice, because annas were divisions of pices in those days. But it was very, very tiny amount. Okay. Maybe it was a pice. Okay, it was a pice.
17 ara make a rupee.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. Okay, but nevertheless, it was a small amount for a person to give, was one paisa. Okay? So, they would go with this box, and they would approach people everywhere. And they would ask them to please donate something. But Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati, actually his intention was not only just to get some donation, but that they would have an opportunity to preach to those people. Because when they would be giving this donation, their hearts would open somewhat, and they would have an opportunity to preach to those people. So these brahmacharis would go out, working very hard, even in the hot, very hot, noonday sun. And one time, Prabhupada was riding by, because he was the revolutionary acharya. No acharyas before him rode in cars. But now, Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati began to utilize everything, whatever technology was needed for his preaching mission. And he was riding in someone's car. And when he was riding by on the road in Mayapur or somewhere around that area, Navadvip, he saw his brahmachari, Vinod Bihari, in the middle of the noonday sun, lying underneath a tree with his head on this box and taking a short nap. When he saw that, Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati's eyes filled with tears and became overwhelmed with affection for this brahmachari. How he had sacrificed everything, his whole youth, everything. And he is doing so much renunciation for me.
And he's coming from which family?
Yes, and coming from such a very, you know, wealthy family, landowner family. Now, when he left, his family and his mother, they were missing him so much. And they wanted him to come back home. And they tried to convince him also to come back home. But he would never do this. And then one day, his mother came, or one of the relatives came, and they tried to talk to Srila Prabhupada to convince his disciple to come home, to take care of some...
His mother was dying.
His mother was dying. Yes, yes. She was on her deathbed. And so they wanted him to return home so that he could meet his mother one last time. So then Prabhupada, he called him and he instructed him, now you should go home and meet your mother. What did he do? He did not do that. He went and hid inside of a room and didn't go and follow that instruction.
2 days?
And 2 days in that room. And at that point, Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati understood that he had not followed his instruction, and he came and found him. And he was chastising, why you did not go? Why you did not follow my instruction? And then he told him, my Guru Dev, what my current situation is. As a conditioned soul, I've been in this material world for millions of lives, and I have not had this opportunity for all these lifetimes to now be at your lotus feet, such an exalted Mahabhagavat personality, powerful preacher of Lord Chaitanya. I have not had this opportunity. And now, if I go to see my mother in her final days, I know that she will instruct me that I should take care of the family, that I should stay there. And I will lose this opportunity. I will have to follow that instruction. And I will lose this opportunity to follow you, to be with you. So therefore I cannot go. And Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur was very, very pleased. Later on, he did take care of some of the family affairs, but he never returned to living there in his home. As the years went by, this Gaudiya mission began to flourish, began to expand, and so many of the intelligent youth of India, the cream actually, of the universities and intelligent youth of that time, they came to the Gaudiya Math and they joined one by one by one. It was like the gathering of the luminaries in the sky, the bright full moon of Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati, and the stars decorating him. So many personalities came to the lotus feet of Prabhupada. And they began to preach vigorously everywhere. But Vinod Bihari Brahmachari, although he was one of these personalities, he was also extremely expert in managing. And he was the fully surrendered disciple of Srila Prabhupada. So he was very much needed as the mission was expanding to take full responsibility for all the organization that was required for the entire preaching mission. So he became the chief manager of all the Gaudiya Mathas, you see. And because he was from such a bold family, he had that nature, like his mother, so he told Srila Prabhupada, because there was some problem one time. You know, the Gaudiya Math owned some land there. And there were some persons who were living on the land, but they required to pay also their rent for living on the land. But they were refusing to do so. So then, this bold personality, Vinod Bihari Brahmachari, he said, I can solve this problem. He said, give me a horse. So, now... A very fine
black horse.
Yes. And he also dressed himself in very sophisticated dhoti, like a Bengali gentleman, landowner gentleman. And he had also a stick in his hand. And he came there to those other persons. And now he beat one of them.
A couple of big guys with him.
And a couple of big ones with him.
Tied this guy to it. It was a Muslim tenant.
Muslim tenant, yes.
He wouldn't pay, and then nobody else would pay.
Right, right.
So they said, tie him to a tree.
Yes.
And in front of everybody.
It was a ringleader.
Yeah, he was like the ringleader. So they beat him as an example.
Yes.
And he was weeping, Oh my God! Yeah, so then everybody was cowed.
Yes. He solved the problem, and never again after that, you see? So, his abilities were so great that Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur, and I'll tell more, how he gave him this title, Kriti Ratna, which means the jewel of those who are very expert performers of great deeds. He's like the Ratna, the jewel of these. So Kriti Ratna he became known as. And one time, the Gurudev of Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur, Gaurakishore Das Babaji Maharaj, the topmost Mahabhagwat. So when he left his body in Srinavadvip Dham years before, his samadhi was made there on the other side of the Ganga. But now the Ganga was flooding as it does at various times of the year. The Ganga sometimes floods very heavy. And there was a danger that this samadhi of Gaurakishore Das Babaji would be thoroughly destroyed, you see, by all the Ganga flood. So, Vinod Bihari Brahmachari, the genius that he was, he devised a method which was incredible in those days, without heavy equipment and cranes and this and that. Somehow or other, he devised a method to actually excavate the entire samadhi from the underground and beneath the samadhi and everything, to somehow or other hoist it up, to bring it somehow or other on bullock carts and so forth to the bank of the Ganga, to somehow or other load it onto to a number of boats that were tied together, carry it across the Ganga, and bring it all the way up the road to the Sri Chaitanya Math, where it is presently located to this day. And everyone was astonished how he was able to do this. This is just one of many, many examples.
And by the court case, it was against the British law to move a grave.
Oh, yes. Well, that's the difference.
Oh, that's it. And so, you're picking it up.
Yeah.
No. This is, they said, you have moved this grave. It was a criminal offense.
Oh.
So they took him to court. And here's the British judge and everybody's cowed.
Yeah.
And he said, we're not under your law. Yes. This is not under your law. We are Vaishnavas. And he explained that this is the sacred samadhi of our guru's guru, which was being threatened. And to not move it would be a great offense.
Yes.
So we do not accept your law in this case. And actually, there was a loophole in the law, because it did allow, in fact, for moving into grave But he stood so boldly and expertly citing case and law, and that became his hallmark later, so many other cases as well. He was expert in court cases, and he was always in court.
Yes. Gurudev said that my Guru Maharaj, at any time, he would always have at least 5 or 10 court cases hanging from him. And there's also pastime in the biography of how he was... I know. Okay. I'll just tell this last one. Yeah. Right. Okay. No, we don't have this morning.
Just
morning,
that's
the last one. Oh, yeah. Okay. Class. Yeah. So I'll just finish this one. He also told lawyers who were very, very well known lawyers. He preached to them one time. You know, this was later on in his Jodi Mutt preaching. And he said to them, you know, that going to courts and fighting in the courts, this is the best service to Bhagavan. And they all said, oh, you know. And then he explained in a very brush-rusic way how in Goloka Vrindavan, how Srimati Radhika and Krishna and the gopis, they enact various legal matters sometimes, and they have court cases where Krishna has to defend himself. And then Lalita Devi is like the lawyer, you know, prosecutor, like this. And then he says, this is real seva to Bhagavan. So anyway, Srila Bhakti Pragyan Keshav Maharaj, extraordinary personality. I've just given a tiny introduction, and hopefully everyone can be a little inspired to